Unless you understand or you feel that I am the worst person, I am the lowest person, do not come. You still have arrogance. You still have self-admiration. You still see yourself above others. The beginning of the path, to start this path, to start the path of purifying my own self, the start is humility. That I'm accepting, I'm the problem. The problem is me, not he, not the masjid, not the society, not the United States, not... I'm the biggest problem on earth, it's me. My biggest concern is me and my state. That's the start. That is very, very important, to omit arrogance. I sit here in front of you, and you ask me, many people sometimes come and say, didn't you see the Muslims are this, the community is that, the masjid is that, our youth is this. Speak to the youth, you know what I mean? Like, you can pinpoint problems, but before speaking to anyone, I have to be of, yes, there is a problem. Are there problems in this masjid? Yes. Do you see problems in this masjid? Of course. You know what's the biggest problem I see in this masjid? Is that I'm sitting here teaching. That's a sign of the hour, if you want. I believe the hour is Yawm al-Qiyamah, Day of Judgment is very close. Did you see the signs of Day of Judgment? I saw one in me. The fact that the likes of me are sitting here today talking in a masjid, for me that's a sign that the Day of Judgment is near. I'm me speaking to you, me telling you about Allah in this community, me, that's a problem. Yeah, this masjid has a problem. And at the same time, you look at it so as not to be negative. And you, at the same time, you say, Alhamdulillah, thank me, yani, all praise and all thanks be to Allah. Why? We are in the likes of me. Had I been born 200, 300, 500 years ago, the likes of me would not be suitable to serve Allah in any position. You know, you look to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this, you go to a company, you know, when you apply for a company, if there is 100 people applying beside a PhD, you know, 100 patents, you know, you say, me, I'm not going to get this job. No way. They're not going to hire me. I'm not suitable. But if you come in a time, there is no one else. There is no engineers left. You're an engineer. You have a BS. You're the best person. So you would be taking that job. So at the same time, I would say, Alhamdulillah that I came in this time. This time that many people would look and, What kind of time we're living in? How horrible is that time, right? Many people would say that. Look at the other look. Alhamdulillah that I'm in this time. Because of this, the likes of me have an opportunity to serve. Had I been in another time, I wouldn't have been... I'm not good for anything. Now, saying this and putting it into practice, Imam Malik, and sometimes they say Hassan al-Basri, people asked him, just to let you know, like, wallahi, I mean this. Me speaking about chivalry, me speaking about good manners, me? You have no idea what that causes to a person like me. Imam Hassan al-Basri, once they asked him, people have so many slaves, why don't you in the next khutbah, you know, great person, why don't you speak about freeing slaves, you know, like advise people to free their slaves. Okay, he goes next Friday, he comes up the pulpit, he speaks, nothing. He goes down. And people, maybe he forgot. We'll wait till next week. Next week, comes up, speak, nothing. Third week, he comes up, different topic. He speaks, finishes the topic. Before going down, he looks at the people, and, oh people, free your slaves. And he goes down, Allahu Akbar. After the salah, it said everyone was freeing the slaves. And people were amazed. He didn't give a khutbah about it. All what you said is one word and everybody obeyed. And you waited 2 weeks. What's going on? Explain. And he said, when you ask me to speak about freeing slaves, I have no slaves. I have no slaves. So I had to wait and save some money first. Then buy a slave myself. And then free him. Then I would tell people to do that. When people ask me to speak about giving charity, you know what you have asked me now to do? Do you understand the concept here? How can I speak about giving charity if you ask me about, don't get angry, right? Be patient. You know what you've asked me to do right here? It's not easy. I need your dua. It's not an easy position to be in. And that's the biggest problem I see in this masjid. It's me. I'm not giving you your right. One has to start with working on my own arrogance, working on my own self-admiration. I acknowledge I have that. As a matter of fact, it ties to the topic we're speaking about. Once Yahya, you know, Prophet Yahya, he asked Jesus, peace be upon him, أَيُّ شَيْءَ أَشَدْ. We discussed this last time. What is the hardest thing on me? What is the, يعني, أَشَدْ, you know, what's the hardest thing that you can possibly encounter? And he answered him. He said, قَالَ غَضَبُ اللَّهِ. The wrath of Allah, the anger of Allah. Everything is on one side, but the anger of Allah, nobody can take that. That's the hardest thing. So immediately the next question, he said, what brings me closer to Allah being angry on me? He said, that you be angry. That you be angry. Be very careful. Remember, we discussed this. Allah is to you the way you are to Him and to the creation. كُنْ لِلَّهِ كَمَا شِئْتْ فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ لَكَ كَمَا تَكُونَ أَنْتَ لَهُ وَلِعِبَادِهِ. You forgive people, you be merciful to people, that's a sign of what Allah is going to do to you. And that's very interesting. أَنَا عِنْدَ ظَنَّ عَبْدِي بِي. You know the Qudsi hadith? I am what my servant thinks of me. This hadith is, even recent scientific theories. Your thoughts create your reality. People who think, oh, there is no God, this universe is godless, right? You know what happens? The universe is to them exactly that way. They're going to live in a universe that's going to react to them the way they are to Allah. If you live in a universe that Allah is all merciful, Allah is there, everything will react similarly to you. Scientifically, and this is not my topic, quantum mechanics says that the foundation of science is consciousness. It's another topic. That you be careful, the way you think creates your reality. You think that people are bad. You go out, you wake up, Muslims are horrible. People in the masjid are this and that. You know what? That's what you're going to see. Happened. I was visiting Egypt once, long time ago, 2-3 years ago, before the revolution. Right? And the state of people, I was going there and alhamdulillah, I see good people. There are good people in Egypt, mashallah. And my brother was complaining. People are this, people are that. They don't care about anything anymore. All what they care is to eat and drink and this and that. And they're like pigs eating, And then we were driving, traffic. And he looks and he sees a woman in the car next to us, right? And she's eating while she's driving. Look at that. Look. Even when they're driving, they're eating. That's what he saw. What I saw was something, I said, subhanAllah. You know what I saw when I looked at her? In the background, there was the adhan of Maghrib. And it's Monday. What was this woman doing? She was fasting. I saw, subhanAllah, good woman, mashallah, I should be doing that. He saw what? Be very careful. The way we think reflects us. مَنْ قَالْ هَلَكَ النَّاسِ فَهُوَ أَهْلَكَهُمْ فَهُوَ أَهْلَكَهُمْ. In one narration, فَهُوَ أَهْلَكَهُمْ. In another narration. Whoever says, people are destroyed, people are perished, people are in such a bad state, he's the one, the first to be in the bad state. When you find a person saying, the Ummah is this, Muslims are that, the world is this, the Prophet tells us he's the one that's like that. And in the other narration, which is again the Dhamma versus Fatha, it is you that caused them to be that way. It is you that think that they are that way. You are responsible for that. So we have to be very careful. Right? So when he was asked, and this is the Prophet Jesus, he said that you be angry. Be very careful. Do not start to be angry on different people. That will cause Allah to be angry on you. And then he said, what makes anger, this anger, and what makes it emerge in my heart? What is the reason for it? What's the cause of it? And indeed the answer came, al-kibr, wal-fakhr, wal-ta'azzuz, wal-hamiyya, arrogance, zealousy, pride, boasting. Those can cause anger. I started with arrogance. And last time you were speaking about this, the ability to, how are we to the creation? When somebody wrongs me, how do I react? Am I fiery? What makes me angry? as an example, Zain al-Abidin. You know Zain al-Abidin, the son of Imam al-Husayn, the son of Ali, right? Ibn Abi Talib. This is from the descendants of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he was known as a Sajjad, the one that prostrates. He used to, some narrations say he prayed 1,000 rak'ahs every day. 1,000. Prostrating. He was known, very generous, very a worshipper. Zain al-Abidin, Zain means the most beautiful. Abidin, worshippers. They named him, his name is Ali. But they named Zain al-Abidin, the most, his worship is amazing. Most beautiful worship. He's walking one day, the descendant of the Prophet. People love him. The worshipper, very generous to people, very chivalrous. And comes a person to him, and he tells him, "Anta Zain al-Abidin? You are Zain al-Abidin?" He said, "Yes." He said, "Anta Shayn al-Abidin? You are the worst of worshippers." And he started slandering him, with cursing him, and people around, the words that this man said, "Yani, you don't say this, how dare you?" So people got really upset. "What are you doing?" And he said, "Leave him." And the man continued. And he said, after the man finished, he said, "My brother, all what you said is in me, and I have more. How can I reward you for your good advice to me?" And he took out his abaya and he gave it to him. This man started crying. He cried, started, and he said, "Ashhadu annaka ibn Rasulillah." I bear witness that you are the son of the Prophet. You're of the descendants of the Prophet, peace be upon him. It is those people over there. They told me, if I can make you angry, they're going to pay me 1,000 dirhams. I said, "Is that it? Here, take 1,000 dirhams." Look at the response. A man slanders him, and his response is what? He didn't see, you understand the meaning here? You are this, you are that, you are that. You're not telling me anything new. Why am I, when somebody slanders me with something, I have worse things. I have worse problems in me. But when I have self-admiration, when I see I'm this, I'm that, I'm Mr. PhD, I'm the greatest sheikh in Orange County, you don't know who I am. Of course that would make me angry if I don't see my defects. Zain al-Abidin, the same person, a person came to him. And worst thing, he looked at him and he spat in his face. Did somebody spit in your face before? Did somebody spit in my... What if I go outside and somebody did that to me out of ignorance? What comes out naturally? Our natural response is what? Anger. Anger. How dare you do this, right? And you want to do what? Especially young guys, I'll beat you up. You know what he said, Zain al-Abidin? This person spits in his face. The face of Zain al-Abidin. So he looks down and he looks at that person. And he said, "My father told me." Who's his father? Imam al-Husayn. "My father told me that his father, Ali, told him, أَنَّ رِيقَ الْمُؤْمِنِ تِرْيَاقٍ أَوْ شِفَاءٍ وَأَنَا اسْتَشْفَيْتُ بِرِيقٍ." That the saliva of the believer is a cure. And I see cure in your saliva. The man cries, and repents. He couldn't... You understand what's going on here? Now, the reason I'm saying this, because some people might say, you know what, this, لا تغضب, don't be angry. It's not, is it right? Sometimes I have to be angry, for the right reasons, right? And some people might argue, you know what, this is not good. What is anger? Is it right to say never be angry? Can you remove anger from one? Is it possible through spiritual exercises to rid myself completely of anger? Is that what we require to do? Is there an anger for Allah? Is the Prophet angry? Is there something like that? Can I be angry for Allah? What are the signs of it? Tell me more about that. Anger, or if I'm afraid if I do that and I start forgiving people, I'll be humiliated. That's one reason why we don't forgive sometimes. And Imam al-Ghazali identifies this, and this hadith I just said identifies this. One reason we do not forgive others, because we think, that means I'm humiliated. I'm in public. He insulted me in public. How dare I forget? You know, like I can't. If I let everybody do that to me, what will happen to me? My reputation. My image. One of the biggest problems we have, sometimes we don't forgive. It's not about forgiving. It's about my image. What will people do? What will people say? And the Prophet ﷺ says, مَزْدَادَ عَبْدْ بِعَفْ إِلَّا عِزَّةً. A servant will not increase by forgiving in anything except honor. The example I just gave, if I walk outside, alhamdulillah, like let's say we pray Aisha, we're alhamdulillah, and I walk outside and you see a person spitting in my face. If I got angry and I said, you know what, here, I spit back in his face, would you respect me? You say, the maximum you'll say, you know what, an eye for an eye, right? But yeah, khalas. He spits in his face, you spit back in his face, he's going to curse you, you're going to curse him. It's not good. But if somebody spits in my face, and I did what Zain al-Abidin did, what is your opinion of me? It's the opposite of what people think. If you think that forgiving will lead, that people would actually, you'd be lowered in the eyes of people, that people are going to think that you're humiliated, it is the opposite. Wallahi, it is, and I'm not speaking about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If your goal was to gain people respect, you will gain the respect by forgiving and pardoning. I respect that. That's a great act. When I read about Zain al-Abidin, subhanallah, I wish I was like that. To repel what's bad with what's good, that's something. That's the manners of the prophets. That's something honorable. Honor is in forgiving, not the opposite. But then comes the question, you know, forgiving, sometimes it's not good, is it? What does that mean? Somebody wrongs me, I just keep forgiving everyone? Where is the line? Where is the boundary? And that needs a little bit of explanation. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Aisha radiallahu anha said, مَنْ تَقَمَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ لِنَفْسِهِ قَطْ وَلَكِنْ This is the rest of the hadith. فَإِذَا ضُيَّعَتْ حُقُوقُ اللَّهِ لَمْ يَقُمْ لِغَضَبِهِ أَحَدْ The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam never sought revenge. Was not angry for himself ever. But if it is about the rights of Allah, nobody can stand in front of his anger. What does that mean? We have to differentiate between two things. First of all, when you wrong, did you wrong me or did you wrong someone else? You spit in my face. Whose rights are being violated here? My right. Chivalry is to drop my right. If it is my right, I drop it. That's the sunnah of the Prophet. For me, I'm not going to get angry. But you spit in the face of one of the sisters there, I'm going to stand against you. It is not chivalry at all to see someone wronging others and say, you know what, let's pardon him. Pardoning is in your rights. When it's the rights of others, you get them the rights first. Is that clear? Right? So when we speak about pardoning, it's about what I own, when it comes to me. When it's my right, but not the rights of others. I don't have the permission or the ability to just tell others, you just forgive him, let's leave him. That's not right. There are many examples for that. And one example, you know, Amr ibn Abdullah or Amr ibn Abd Qais, one of the great tabi'een. Great tabi'een, great man. And by the way, there is a reason why I'm speaking about a lot of stories. One way to, as we discussed before, to gain good manners is to speak about people with good manners, is to cling my heart to them, is to know their stories. The more I know of that, the more it helps me. Remember companionship? And we said, remember what we said? One way, what did we say? One way to get good manners is companionship. And remember what I advised people here with? Go into nature, remember that? Walk into nature, walk into the fields, walk by the ocean. What does that have to do with manners? It has everything to do with manners. And remember what we said? People in the countryside and people in the city, people in the countryside, generous, forgiving, kind, people in big cities, agitated, angry. Because when you walk in nature, those are the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in dhikr, in tasbih. That affects me. Those are the signs of God. This is like a big mosque for us. I'm walking in a big mosque. Everything is worshipping God. And I just join in, it affects me. Right? So talking about those people, that's why I'm saying a lot of stories, help me. It's one way. So Amr ibn Abd Qais, for you yani, who don't know him, great worshipper, one of the tabi'een, student of the companions, great knight in times of battle, one that's very strong. Everybody, when it's time for battle, everybody wants him on his side. You know, be with me, because very, very courageous, right? Very foregoing, very strong. But at the same time, his worship was amazing. They narrate one narration that a person followed him at night. Nighttime, he slept, they were together, and then that person said, let me see what he does. After everybody slept, he walks away, goes into the wild, away from people. and starts praying, Allahu Akbar. And that person sat and he said, I sat the entire night. This man, he kept praying, up and down and sujood. He said, I never saw someone pray that way. Most beautiful prayers. And he said, at the very end of the prayers, I hear him making dua, he supplicates to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he says the following, Ilahi, my Lord, you asked me, you are the one that placed me in the life of this world. And you told me, hold fast, be steadfast. How can I be steadfast if you do not hold me? And then he said, oh my dear God, I asked you of three things. You gave me two and you held one back. Please give it to me so I can worship you the way I want. And he starts crying and the man is like, what's going on? And he kept crying and praying till the time Fajr, you know, the sun started rising. And he finishes his salah by this dua. He finishes and he says, oh my Lord, the day is coming up. The sun is rising. And your servants, your ibad are going to wake up. Every one of them has a need. Every one of them is looking for something. Oh dear God, give everyone what he seeks. What he seeks and what he wants and what he needs. And give me what I need. And my biggest need is for you to forgive me. Now, right there is something of chivalry here. What did he do? Spend the entire night, you know, prayers, dua. But he made dua for everyone. Do you understand that? That's chivalry. The rights of others. Others have a right on me. That I include them in my prayers. We need people like that today that would spend the entire night praying and at the end of the day pray for everyone. And that his biggest need is what? For God to forgive him. And when that person, by the way, went and told him, what are those? Yani, I heard you. And Amr ibn Abdullah was disturbed. You saw what I did tonight? He said, yes. He said, please don't tell anyone. Don't tell anyone about what I did. Please hide it. And he said, okay, you tell me about those three things you're asking God. If you don't, I'm going to tell everyone. And he said, okay, I'm going to tell you on one condition. You don't tell anyone. He said, yes, I'm not going to tell anyone as long as you're alive. After you die, another story. That's how we know about it, right? So he said, what are they? He said, well, the first thing, I was so, the desire for women, the desire for, you know, the opposite gender. I was so afraid from it that I asked my Lord basically to curb my desires for the young people. There is a big lesson there. I admit my weakness. If I'm a person, I'm weak. I have a desire for the opposite gender and I'm afraid from it. And he kept pleading, Allah, please God, help me curb this. Help me curb it. I'm afraid it's going to destroy me. And he said, he indeed responded to me. So now, alhamdulillah, he even said, whether it's a woman or a wall, I don't care. That's his level, right? Alhamdulillah, it's very curbed. And he said, what was the second thing? He said, I asked him, I don't want to be afraid from anything more than you. And God responded to me, now I don't care who is it. I'm not afraid of anything. He said, what was the third thing? He said, the third thing, I asked him to remove sleep from me so I can worship him all the time. I don't want to sleep. And he didn't give me that. First, you understand what that man is yearning for? You see his yearn? The reason I'm telling you this is يعني, Amr ibn Abdullah is a description. Now, where is chivalry in all this? First of all, when he was to go in a battlefield, let's say, and the soldiers want him with him, he would say three conditions. I would go with you under three conditions. What are they? Number one, I would be the one spending on all of you. That's chivalry. You understand that statement? You want me to be with you? Yes. You have to accept my condition. What is my condition? I'm going to be. No one of you is going to be spending. If I'm with you, I spend on all of you. Number one. Number two, I'm the one to serve all of you. I'm your servant. No one should struggle or try to take that away from me. I'm the one that cleans your clothes. I'm the one that, you know, me. And the third one, adhan. I'm the one to do adhan. Don't take adhan away from me. Right? And he would follow them. So he's known. He's very brave. The reason I'm mentioning this is a brave person. This is a person with rank, with status, right? It is said one time he was in a caravan. And people in the caravan, there was a lion back in the day. You know, a mountain lion, a big lion standing in their way. And everybody's scared back in the day. And Amr ibn Abdullah just goes down. And he said, what are you doing? Don't go down from your right, there is a lion. And he goes down, he goes to the lion. Takes him from the ear. Tells him, get out of the way. Seek your provision somewhere else. And people were like, what? How did you do that? Weren't you afraid? said, I felt shy to be afraid from anything other than Allah. And he said, those are the creation of Allah. If he wills, he withholds them. And if he wills, he leashes them or unleashes them. So that's a person, his heart, courage, right? You understand what I'm saying? Now, here comes the part I want to concentrate on. One day, this great warrior in the battlefield, great person, he's walking in Basra and he sees a non-Muslim, Christian maybe. And here is a policeman grabbing that Christian man, pushing him. And that man is seeking, you know, help. Help me. The dhimma of Muhammad. I mean, you know, I'm in the, under the trust of your prophet. I'm a person that have a covenant. I'm living with you. And Amr ibn Abdullah immediately goes, what's wrong? What did you do something wrong? No. And then he said, he looked to the policeman. What are you doing to him? He said, I'm taking him so that he would clean the garden of the chief of the police, you know, like the head. Like, he needs someone to clean the garden, so that's a Christian, just get him. And Amr ibn Abdullah said, look to the man, are you happy doing this? Does this come with, yani, do you agree? He said, no, I'm not happy. He said, no way I'm going to let you do anything to that man. The dhimma of Muhammad, the trust of Muhammad will not be violated while I'm living. And he takes out his coat, puts it on the man. This again. He now starts doing what? Pushing the soldier away. And the soldier pushes back. And soldiers come. And Amr ibn Abdullah starts defending the Christian. And people gather. And people know Amr ibn Abdullah. This is a great... And they aid him because he's a tabi'i. He's a great person, great scholar. And they aid him. And they push away the police. And they save that person. Now what happens is it becomes a fitna. The police, of course, got really angry. And they start accusing this person of what? He's a person that's challenging the authorities. He's a person that's causing a rebellion. And you know what it happens? You know, like, they start writing reports. Reports, right? And that's exactly what happened. They started writing to the superiors. We have a fitna. We have instigators. We have people doing this. Amr ibn Abdullah is leading a rebellion. He does not comply. He does not obey. And it was a big fitna. And they got Amr ibn Abdullah, a long story. And they questioned him. And at the time, they saw nothing wrong with what he did. And he said, he's free. But it became a point of dispute. And Amr ibn Abdullah had his followers, and the police had their followers. And it was clash. So the ruler of the time, Uthman ibn Affan, the great Khalifa, said, nope, I don't want problems. Amr ibn Abdullah, leave the city of Basra. To avoid problems, to avoid this confrontation, leave the city of Basra. Just leave, go to Sham, go somewhere else. And people were very angry. How dare you, this great worshipper, this great abid, this great, we're honored to have him, great scholar. You guys, you do that to him. And so he complied. And he gathered his things. And on the way out, and people are behind him. I want you to imagine, people, right? Revolution. And if he says they'll follow, he's walking outside. And then on the outskirts of the city, he says, I'm going to make dua, I'm going to supplicate. So say Ameen. And he raises his hands. And he said, oh Lord, whoever said lies about me, whoever transgressed against me, whoever led me to get out of my city that I love and separated between me and my friends. And people said, yeah, you know, like, Amr ibn Abdullah, I was going to. He said, oh Allah, forgive them. Grant them health, give them a good, blessed life. And forgive me and all the believers. And he directed his camel towards Hashem and walks. Where is chivalry here? When it was the right of a Christian, not a Muslim, what did he do? Did he say, oh, we'll forgive them? Yes. No. He fought for it. It cost him his own town. It cost him his own self. When it's the rights of other, I stand for it. But when it was his own right, what did he do? He forgave and asked God to forgive everyone. That is chivalry. That is anger well placed. You understand the concept now? For me, I forgive. For me, I pardon. But the rights of others, I bring it to them. Now, having said that, what is anger? Why is it in us? Can you curb it? Is it good? Is our purpose to completely destroy anger? You know when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam tells us, لا تغضب, don't be angry. What does he mean? Don't be angry, period. Is that what's meant here? What is going on? So scholars speak about this, looking on anger. And subhanAllah, it's interesting. I don't know. They tell you the human being, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the human being. And He's the most wise. He placed things in the human being that would aid us in our journey. You know when you, as an engineer, you design a car, right? I have a dial like the fuel. And it has a purpose. You know the alarm, that the seat belt is not there. I don't want to annoy you with the alarm. That's not why I did it. Right? This beep, beep, right? The purpose is what is actually to alert you something is wrong, right? Everything has a wisdom. The human being is in a similar way. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created things in us. He created forces in us. A human being, and even in animals you can find that. The concept of shahwa, desire, for example. Look to an animal. If an animal wants to eat, they're driven by their desire. They seek, they go, right? A human being has that. I have desires. But at the same time, if you encounter a danger, there is fear. You know, this concept of fear. And for an animal, it's good. Because when they encounter a danger, they run. That saves their life. So there is desires, but fear can overcome that. Even if they want to eat something, a bird wants to eat some seeds. If I do that and put seeds here, I'm not going to come. I'm afraid of you, right? But there is a third one, anger. You can see it in animals. You can, a cat. A cat is afraid from me. But you approach a cat while she has a kitten, what will the cat do? She'll attack you. She knows that I'm bigger than her, right? I'm stronger than her, but what will she? It attacks, right? See, that's anger. Anger overpowers fear. What is the purpose of it? And look at the wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to protect the weak. Anger has two purposes. Number one, the reason I get angry, a big bully outside, he bullies me. I might get, you know, khalas, I see him bullying one of the sisters over there. You know, the blood boils, you know what happens? Anger. And when you're angry, what happens? You know, when we're angry, fear is gone, right? That's it. Enough is enough, right? And now I stand. The purpose of it is now I'm doing what? Protecting someone who I envision to be weak, cannot get his right. So anger, the positive way of it, it is a force in me that helps me overcome my fear and my desires to protect the weak. The worst thing you can do is what? You take God's blessing and use it in an opposite manner. When I find my anger now is directed to oppressing the weak, domestic violence, hitting my wife, that's a crime. It was supposed to be to protect her. You get angry because, where is dinner? Anger. It was supposed to protect her. If that was placed in you to protect your children, to protect an elderly person, to protect those who are not capable of defending themselves, that's the function of it. To bring the rights of others to them, not to oppress them. And the second one, which is more important, and Imam Al-Ghazali outlines this very clearly, anger can be directed inwardly, to discipline oneself. And he says, whoever does not have anger would be very hard for him to discipline and purify. You know this, we're speaking about akhlaq, manners, and how to gain good manners and chivalry. One of the fastest ways to gain that is to direct anger inwardly, towards me. I know this concept is a little bit strange, but maybe with examples I can help. I can help maybe bring it to life more. 2006, 2008. Remember the war in the Middle East, Israel, Middle East, Lebanon, the fight, Iran, and people get angry, right? You can direct your anger outwardly. I mean, we are so much known to do that. Like, we direct our anger out. Wallahi, if we direct our anger, 1/10 of it inwardly, we will change. We will change. Because when I see oppression, when I see people oppressed in Lebanon, in Palestine, when I see it's an oppression, they need my help, right? And I get really angry. And this is something I really did personally. And I said it before and I'm going to say it again. This is something I really said. Oh, brother, are you angry? Yes. It is for the sake of God. I'm angry for the sake of God, right? Really? Yeah, it is for the sake of God. That's good anger, right? Okay, you're really angry about it? Yes. Think that way. What if the entire ummah, what if all the Muslims are like me? What will happen? So you're angry, right? Really? Okay, I want you to do something about it. Can you donate some money for the people there? Yes, of course. You know, here is a check, $1,000. Keep your check. I didn't ask you to donate one time. You're really angry? People are oppressed there. You need to be doing something about it, right? Anywhere in the world, right? There is homeless people in Los Angeles. Do you see that? I should be angry for that. Are you angry for them? There are homeless people in Anaheim, beside Disneyland. People, homeless. Do you see them? Are you angry for them? So you're angry, yes. You need to do something. Donate. Here is $1,000. You know why I'm saying this is not correct? You're angry. You're going to, here is $1,000. And that's it. No. Directed inwardly. Are you truthful? Really? Yes. You're really angry? Yes. For the sake of God? Yes. Donate 10% of your income every month. Can you do that? Are you angry for Palestine? Are you angry for Libya? Are you angry for Iraq? Are you angry for the homeless people here? Yes. أصدق الله يصدق. Be truthful with Allah. Let's see. Your anger is for God or not. Donate. Not one time. 10% of your wealth every month. What happens? What do you find? I'm asking you today, if I ask you today, there is fundraising and I want you, you know your bank account, 20%. What do you find coming inside? No, right? Difficult, right? Every month, no way, that's too much. I can tell you something even worse. I can tell you the following. You live in a 4-bedroom house, right? Move your family into a 2-bedroom apartment with the difference in price donated to that cause. What do you see in yourself? No way. I'm not going to jeopardize my living standard. You see that? What does that say about me? Oh, you're inflicted with miserness, aren't you? You're inflicted with greed, aren't you? And if everyone else is like you, what will happen? If everyone else is like me, that's why things do not change. Now, when I see this, when I see, oh my God, what happened? The homeless people, Lebanon, Libya, you name it. Just revealed for me something in me that I am miser. I am. Now I get angry, not outwardly, on me. I cannot be that way. People are dying. People are dying every day. And I can give 10% of my wealth. How can I be this way? See my anger now? I will not be that way. This self of mine needs discipline. I cannot let it be. My anger now is where? Here. Now, I'm ready to do what? Purify myself. Same thing. You're really angry. There are homeless people, people in Lebanon, people in Libya. Why don't you make salah for them? Pray. Oh, alhamdulillah, we do that when the event happens, when CNN puts the pictures on, right? Injustice is still there. People in Libya are still suffering. People in Syria are still suffering. People in Lebanon and Palestine, they're still suffering. The homeless are still homeless outside. Make dua every night, half an hour. Can you? Can I? No. Too much to ask. What does that say about me? Is that anger for Allah? Is that... Now I cannot stay this way. I cannot stay this way. I can't accept this. See this? I cannot accept this from me. I'm angry when people violate the laws of God. Right? People say that. You know, you come to the masjid sometimes and you pray and there is this kid in the back and he starts crying and what most people would do. So, this is a good example. It happens in the masjid. I see that. You know, a kid in the back and he cries and everyone after salah goes to discipline your kids, my salah, my khushu', right? And you ask, brother, I'm angry for God. First of all, to a level it's good. When we're angry, the first thing to look at, what are you angry over? The worst thing when it is a matter of things of this world. I'm angry over somebody scratching my car. I'm angry for someone, you know, the worldly matters. But this person, no, I'm angry because it's my prayers. There is no khushu'. I couldn't concentrate. My prayers are not going to be accepted. People should discipline themselves, right? You see that? There's a problem right here. Many problems right here. Like what? First of all, you mean to tell me Look how you're treating Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Look at, basically the reason you're angry, you have rules that were violated. We get angry, one reason why we get angry, when certain rules that we have get violated. The question is, those rules, who set them? My rule is, I have to have khushu' in salah, I have to concentrate in salah for Allah to accept my prayers. That kid over there, he is the one that yani, caused me not to have khushu' and my prayers is gone and end, right? Well, you know what? That's not true. That might be the only salah that's accepted from you. What do you mean? If Allah was to treat you the same way, okay, you claim that, you know what, the salah is not accepted because you don't concentrate. If Allah treats you that way, He said, okay, fine. I'm not going to accept any of your prayers unless you concentrate fully in it. Which salah of mine is accepted now? As a matter of fact, now another person sees it differently. Subhanallah, there is a kid crying in the back. Right? He interferes with my concentration. That's outside of my hands. That's not someone else, right? It's a decree. It's not in my hands. Allah sees that. Therefore, there is an excuse for me not to have a concentration in that prayer. That might be the only time that Allah would find an excuse for you, and that might be the only salah that God accepted from you. Specifically, imagine now if I'm praying and this kid starts crying and I got disturbed and I made dua for him. May Allah make him from the righteous. May Allah calm the heart of his mother. That might be the reason why this salah is accepted for you. When I go back and I'm angry, I ask myself, did you make dua for people in the masjid? Did you make dua for him regularly, which is what I'm saying? No. You're not giving them the rights. Before asking for your rights, give them the rights. So making dua regularly, what's happening in as I said, Libya, what's happening in... I can't be this way. I need to change. I did this with the brothers. I told them, you know what? 2008, remember what happened in Gaza and the disasters that's happening there and calamities in the Middle East now. SubhanAllah. May Allah yani bring tranquility and peace everywhere. So I said the following, let's fast. Fast. And then when you break your fast, there is a hadith, when you break your fast and you make dua, the dua is accepted. So let's fast, break the fast, make dua for them. And people were, yes, good. I said, but here is the thing, don't stop. Because usually what happens, good idea, we'll do it as long as the pictures are on CNN. For 1 week, 2 weeks, after that what happens? I said, no. We will continue to fast till this problem is solved. What do you mean? Continue to fast for the rest of your life, Mondays and Thursdays. It's the sunnah to fast Mondays and Thursdays. I want you to fast Mondays and Thursdays, every Monday, every Thursday. There are people homeless still there. The situation in Libya is still the same. The situation in Palestine is the same. They still need your dua. Why are you stopping? Because they removed the picture from CNN? They still need... Why do we react? Why do we have to wait till a calamity happens then? Why don't you make dua from the beginning? Before it happens. And then what happens? Can you fast now? Are you angry for what happened? Are you angry for Libya? Are you angry for Syria? Yes. Fast every Mondays and Thursdays and ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to relieve brothers and sisters there. What is the natural response? I can't. Especially if I say what? Lifelong. It's the sunnah. I can't. What are you telling me? What are you telling me? You're not willing to fast one day? And what are you asking? You're angry for people. Where are the Muslim rulers? You know, why are people accepting this? They should do something. What are you saying? That they should give up their life, their wealth, their status, their safety. That's what you're asking them to do, to fight oppression, right? And you sit back, you're not willing to give 2 days. Is that acceptable? No. Now I get, you see my anger? My anger is directed inwardly. We have people up till today, since 2008, fasting Mondays and Thursdays, breaking their fast, making dua for the brothers in Palestine. It's good. That's anger that's directed inwardly. That's positive, it's not negative. Do you understand the concept here? So anger, one of the reasons of it is to discipline the self. And that's something I think, Allah Ta'ala A'lam, we need a lot of nowadays. Now, I want quickly to mention one thing, and I'll close with this. I don't have time to cover everything. The topic of even anger and how to uproot it. It is not, first of all, it is not required of us to uproot anger completely from the heart, as I said, because it's a gift. It's not required. What's required is One statement. Al-Mahmud ghadab yantadhir isharat al-aql wal-deen. The praiseworthy anger is anger that waits the command of deen, religion, and mind, wisdom. You get angry and you look, you know, don't act. You wait. Anger for the weak. Anger against myself. Anger when the rights of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are violated. And there are signs for it. I can give you some signs quickly. I don't have time to discuss them, but here are some signs. People tell you, I'm angry for Allah. Anger for Allah does not exclude on myself. But you know what I mean? You find some Muslim drinking. Oh, look at that. He's drinking. I'm angry on him. How many times did you violate the rights of Allah yourself? In my salah, how is my khushu'ah? Isn't that wrong? Are you angry on yourself? When was the last time you felt anger on the rights of Allah should not be violated? Correct? Including by me. Right? If my anger is because of the rights of Allah's being violated, I'll find that many times I'm angry on me. If I'm never angry on me, please don't be angry on anyone. Because it's not for the sake of Allah. That's the sign. Sometimes we're sick. You know, a sick person, I'll put it that way. There are things that are halal, mubah. It is allowed for you to eat rice. It's allowed for you to drink juice. It's allowed for you to eat fruits, right? But if I'm sick, for that sick person, something that's lawful, something that's allowed, something that's healthy, you'll tell him, you do not eat it. Someone who's diabetic, don't eat honey. But the Prophet said honey is cure. I know. It's a hadith, right? Correct. But that, he's a diabetic person. Don't eat honey. You see the concept? Why? Because you have a disease. So when you have a disease, something that's lawful might not be good for you. Why am I saying this? Because many people, they get angry and they look to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Oh, the Prophet did this and the Prophet was angry here. Be careful. You are sick. I'm sick. And when I'm sick, certain things I cannot do. I have to be very careful. If I find that I'm this angry person, agitated all the time, and I see somebody else doing something wrong, my recommendation is don't speak yourself. Seek someone else to speak to him. Why? Enjoining what's good and forbidding what's evil, yes, but if I'm sick, I can't do that properly. I don't have compassion. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he did that, it was compassion. A story narrated by Qadi Ayyad in Al-Shifa. A Bedouin came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in front of everyone. And he started asking, give me. Be generous, give. And the Prophet started giving him. And then the Prophet asked him, was I good to you? Did you find me? And in front of everyone he said, no. This is unfair. You did not do anything good. You did. And the companions got really upset. Just tell that to the Prophet. Can you imagine someone who comes and he asks you. You know when somebody asks for your help and you're generous to him and then he insults you? What will happen from me? You don't deserve it. Give it back, right? Is that what I get for helping you? Imagine he did that to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The companions of the Prophet could not take this. They got angry and he said, leave him. Stay where you are. Leave him. He said, come with me. Come home. He invited him to his house. Can you imagine somebody insulting you and the next thing comes from you is what? I'm inviting you to my home. Come. And he goes in and he starts bringing things and he gives him. And he said, now are you happy? And he said, yes. But look what the Prophet sallallahu, look at not only his words, look at his heart. Where is he looking? He says, you said something in front of my companions out there. And he got agitated and angry. Right? Tomorrow, I want you to come. And I'm going to ask you the same thing. Are you happy? And say in front of them that you are. Why? What is the Prophet looking for here? You see that? You said something in front of them. They're angry at you. I want to diffuse that. So I want you tomorrow to come and I'll ask you and you say whatever you said so they'll be happy with you and things go to normal. See that? And he comes next day and he asks him in front of everyone and he praises the Prophet. Yes, you're so generous. Right? And everyone was happy now. And then after he left, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught us this lesson. He told us the following. The like of what you and what happened, this example is the like of someone who had a camel. And he lost his camel. You know, his camel is like running away. And people tried to help. And the people tried to catch the camel. The more they run after the camel, the more it runs away. They want to help, but they, you know, catch it. So that man said, leave me alone with my camel. And then he looked to the ground, got some grass. What does the camel want? What is he running after, right? So he got some grass from the ground, and he did this to the camel, come. And that camel came to his owner, right? He gave him the grass, and he took the camel. And he said, had I left you yesterday with that person, you were so angry, you would have killed him out of anger. And he might have entered hellfire because of what he did. What was the focus of the Prophet? Somebody insults you. You understand what he's... Can you imagine his state? When somebody insults me, you know what he's looking at? How can I make you repent? Somebody insults me. The first level is what? Suppress my anger, right? Second level, try to forgive, right? Third, show generosity. But you see the concern of the Prophet? You're not hurting me, you're hurting yourself. What you're doing is bad for you. How can I make you turn back to God? What do you want? Are you angry over what? The life of this world? And this is another lesson. 90% of the time, as I said before, we get angry over things that are unnecessary. Imam al-Ghazali says that there are two or three categories. There is one category, the necessities of life. You'll get angry when the necessities of life are taken away. If somebody, you know, squeezes your neck, you can't breathe. It's natural to get angry. And it's positive to get angry. If somebody deprives you of water and food, naturally you'll get angry. And Imam al-Ghazali says, don't try to uproot that anger because those are necessities. And necessities, he says three things. The hadith of the Prophet, whoever wakes up with enough food for the day, safety in his house, healthy in his body, it's as if he owned this world. Those are essential things in life. Those are things that everything else is commodities. A car is a commodity. Really. Air condition is a commodity. Right? So the Prophet ﷺ is teaching here, what did this camel, what did it take for me to bring the camel back? What did it take for me to save the camel? Is it grass that you want? Give him the grass. Same thing. Somebody that is fighting with me, somebody, what are you angry over, brother? What is it? A car? Somebody who's getting divorced. And, astaghfirullah, what you see in courts nowadays. Yani, Sheikh Yasser was telling us, wallahi, things are horrible. That he saw a car, somebody's driving, a woman is driving, and you know the license plate? It writes on the license plate. Was his. Was his. You understand the concept? We got so angry, right? He did, she did, I'll make her pay. She will see. And the children in the middle. And you pay $100,000 for the lawyers for getting rich. My brother, it's my right. Islam says, it's your right. Chivalry, give your right. What is she fighting you over? A car? Give it to her, yeah. It's a car. No! See that? The more I get attached to this life, the more I get angry. The more gadgets, the more materialistic I am, the more my heart clings to things, the more I would get angry in this life. And the Prophet is teaching, most of the time, save people. If giving them something of this life would save them, would she wouldn't go to court, she wouldn't do haram things. Maybe she goes to court and she brings a false witness and you know, I want her not to do that. I don't want her to be that. I don't want her to suffer. I want her to repent. How can I do that? If giving money is the way, give like Zain al-Abidin, remember? He gave $1,000 to the person. If that's what it takes for you to repent, here, take it. I don't want it. Ja'far ibn Muhammad, a person once in Hajj, a person came and he had a sack of money, basically, in those days, 1,000 dinars or 1,000 dirhams, and he lost it. And he clinged to, he found Ja'far ibn Muhammad, he was angry. So he clings to him. And this is a great, great scholar from the descendants of the Prophet. He clings to him. You stole my bag, you stole my money, you. Right? In front of everyone. And he said, how much money was in it? 1,000 dirhams. He says, okay, come here. 1,000 dirhams. And the man takes it and goes away. And then after a while, the same man came back, head down. Sir, I'm sorry, I found my bag. Here is your money. He said, the money is yours to keep. The money that comes out of my pocket, I don't take again. That's chivalry. Because he told him something, he told him what? Do you understand what happened to that man now? He changed. I want to change people. What helps me is what helps the Prophet. The Prophet's concern was what? Mercy to mankind. I want good for you. You're my brother, even when you wrong me, even when you do something wrong. And I finish with this hadith that I think helps us, because I said, if you remember a long time ago, our manners are derived from the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is this hadith, and I say it quickly. A man one time, sahih hadith, he wanted to, narrated by Abu Huraira, wanted to give charity, and he's sincere, a very sincere person. So he goes, night time, nobody sees, in secrecy. He goes out and he gives charity. He finds this man, gives him charity, comes back, and then all of a sudden, next day, he hears the entire town speak. Entire town is mocking. What? Yesterday, somebody gave charity to a thief. Can you imagine? And now he's the talk of the town, and everybody's mocking him. What? Look at those crazy people. They're giving their charity to thieves. Can you believe that, man? And that person said, Ya Allah, to a thief, Allahumma laka alhamd. Oh Allah, all praise be to you. To a thief, La tasaddaqanna al-layla. I'm going to give a charity tonight again. He didn't stop. He didn't say, people are mocking me. They don't deserve, they're bad people. My response would have been something like that. You try to do something good, right? To help others, and the feedback is negative. I stop. That's a sign that I'm not truthful. It wasn't for God. It was for people's praise, and people insults should not make me stop. If it is for the sake of God, I continue. And that man was truthful. Allah tasaddaqanna al-layla again tonight. He goes the night time. Find this woman, gives her charity, goes back happy. Next day, everybody's mocking. Oh, do you see what happened? This man, he appeared again last night. تصدق على بغي. He gave charity to a woman that's a prostitute. Oh, can you believe that? What a crazy man. And he's like, Ya Allah, على بغي. اللهم لك الحمد. لا تصدقنا الليلة. Again, look at, this is truthfulness. Does not stop. Again, I'm going to repeat again. I have to. He goes out at the night, find the person, gives him money, goes back. And next day, the town is talking again. That crazy man yesterday, he appeared again. تصدق على غني. He gave charity to a rich person. And can you imagine the talk of the town now? Like, can you imagine how he feels when you walk in the town and everybody's mocking that crazy man? And he says, Allahumma laka alhamd. Yani ala baghi, ala sariq, ala ghani. But he doesn't stop. That's a lesson in truthfulness. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is revealed. Your charity is accepted. And look at this. As for the thief, may that cause him to stop stealing. As for the woman that's doing that, may that cause her to stop and cease even for one night. As for the rich person, may that remind him that people are giving charity, lest may he too give charity. When you read this hadith, what is it telling me? Many people see the man, great man, truth, but it tells me something else. Look at Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What does Allah care about? There are people dying on the street. There are people that are hungry. There are people that can't. Those are people in need, right? But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sees the people of most need are not those people. The people of real need are not the homeless people. They're the people that are away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The people that are sinning and their sins humiliate them. This woman doing that thing, this thief, that is the one that needs the most. And that is the one that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, God is concerned about. Can you imagine? That is the one that God wants back. That is the one that I want him. And in the Quran, that's exactly what it says. Wallahu yuridu an yatubu alaykum. Allah wants, Rabbil Alameen, Allah wants you to turn back to him. He loves you to turn back to him. Allah loves at-tawabeen. Inna Allah yuhibbu at-tawabeen. He loves people that are sinners when they turn back to him. If I live, and I don't have time to elaborate, if I live by this attribute, Ya Allah, is that what you love? Do you understand? Ask any father, you can relate to this. Ask any mother, if you have a child, you have two children, one of them is good, but one of them goes astray, gets a wrong companionship, starts doing drugs, and leaves the house. What is your concern as a parent? I love my good child. You can come and praise my good child. I'm happy, thank you for praising my child. But if you are the person that went out and talked to my child who left the house, and you convinced him to come back to the house, what will I do? Will I be happy? Ask any parent who has a child like that. they would do anything. They would be the most happy person on earth if that child just comes back. Of love, right? If you were the person that brought him back, how thankful they will be to you. Do you understand the concept? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is more generous, more compassionate. He wants the most people to remember. Right? I'm angry for him. You should not be doing this. Why are you doing that? You know better. Why are you doing this? Why are you doing drugs? Your ego is killing you. You see, my anger is directed. You're the one that God honored. You're the one that God wants. How can I bring you back? There is anger there. But you see how the anger is directed? My words now are out of what? Compassion. I'm angry. I'm angry about drugs. Who gave him that? I should stop that. Drug dealers, I should stop that. Positive anger. But for him, what you're doing is haram. Drinking wine is haram. Why? You don't do that. God honored you. You have intellect. Don't lose it. Don't. So, you see, anger with compassion is different. It's for that person. It brings him back. And that's a sign for al-ghadab billah. It's always good. So number one, anger for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not exclude me. Number two, anger for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with compassion. It leads to good things. Number three, anger for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala conforms to sharia, conforms to legal rulings. The child that cries in the masjid, I'm Allahu Akbar, I'm praying, and there's a child crying, right? The least you can do if you got angry, you think that way. What did the Prophet do? If yani, I don't know what to do. Did that happen in the time of the Prophet? Yes. What did he do? What do you know of the Prophet? Look at his response. He's leading the prayer, and you all know the hadith. When he hears a child crying, what does he do? He makes the prayer shorter. Okay. Don't lose focus. Where is his heart? It's not about just following the act. What was the condition of the heart that led to this? Why did he do that? What was it? Because he said, out of compassion for the mother of that child. Can I make my heart that way? So I hear a child crying. I want to follow the Prophet. What does that mean? I have to bring my heart to feel what? His mother now must be, yani. And I must extract from my heart what? Compassion for her condition. What is she must be feeling? You see, that's following the Prophet. It's compassion, love. Following Sharia. So his sunnah is to do what? Make your prayer faster. It's okay. It wasn't anger. Oh, but brothers, we keep telling them. We keep telling them. We keep advising them. They don't listen. Okay. How many times do you sin against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? How many times does He keep telling you do not and you violate? If I see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as a tawwab, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is willing to accept and loves people to repent. And you're wrong. And you know the hadith when a person does a sin and he says, Ya Rab, I did a sin. Forgive me. And God speaks to the angels. Do you understand the meaning here? You are a sinner. I'm a sinner. I'm a person that sinned. Theoretically, I'm the one that's lowest. I become the talk of God and the angels. Why? Because you sought forgiveness from God. God says, my servant, he committed a sin. But he asked for forgiveness. I make you witness, I forgive him. And the hadith continues, that servant would slip again and again. And then God, please forgive me. And God says to the angels, my servant did a sin, slipped, asked for forgiveness, but he slipped again. And he asked for forgiveness. I forgive him. The third time, he slips and he asks for forgiveness. And God says, my servant, he slips, he asks for forgiveness. He slips again, he asks for forgiveness. He slips again and he asks for forgiveness. Oh, my angels, my servant knows that he has a God that can forgive all sins. I make you witness that I forgive him. Let him do whatever he pleases. So if God is willing to forgive once, twice, thrice, four times, 10 times, you get angry for a person because I told him once and he did not listen? Do you want God to treat me that? Do I want God to treat me that way? How many times, how much is he patient over us? If I see God as the most patient, as-sabur, al-halim, I can't but show that to people. The reason, Simple, finish with. The reason why we cannot show good deeds, good manners to people, because we have not experienced how Allah treats us. If you go to work, you go late to work, and you expect my boss is going to be angry, but he tells you, you were late today. You say, oh yeah, I was late. He tells you, no, no, I'm not, did something happen? I'm just asking to see, are you okay? He says, yeah, yesterday my kid was sick and I spent the night. And he says, okay, you know what? Your kid is sick. Why don't you take the rest of the day off? But work, I'll take care of it. Just go home. Don't worry, I'll do your job for you. Go home, take care of your kid. You go home and you find that he sent flowers to you. That's a B. I experienced something, right? Now I go back to work next day. And one of my co-workers or fellow comes late to work. What will happen? Will I be angry at him? Impossible, right? Why? If I had experienced such kind of treatment, if I lived it, if I was shown this kind of good treatment, I cannot help but to be the same. The reason why I cannot forgive, why I cannot be compassionate, why I cannot pardon, it's because I have not experienced those from God. I do not know God as the most. I claim I know. I didn't experience it. If you experienced Him, if you know what He is, you'll feel shy not to forgive His servants. How can I not say? How can I? He's willing to forgive them. He's willing to. He wants them back. He wants them back, and I push them away. When I see somebody who's doing something wrong, this is the one that He wants. This is the one that my concern is how to bring him back. And that is a big driver for me to have good manners. Tawheed. Real Tawheed. Experiential Tawheed. Experiential oneness of God and His attributes. And yani, I would like to stop here inshallah. Although I would say the topic is not done. The concept of chivalry. But I hope this is, I would say, a brief introduction, if you will, to that topic. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to benefit all of us. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us all and guide us all to the best of manners. Nobody guides to them except Him. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to remove from us all bad manners. Nobody removes it from our hearts except Him. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك لا إله إلا أنت نستغفرك ونتوب إليك والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر جزاكم الله كل خير. And please don't forget me from your dua, inshallah.